What's happening? This is Cheech.
And this is Chong.
And we're like gonna be on the Friday night show on Friday. Oh. So we're getting ready for it now, so you do whatever you gotta do. So be sure to be up.
Just your average Chinese-Mexican comedy team, Cheech and Chong, grocers of $60 million in box office receipts this year. That and more next on Friday night.
Real gross.
I want you to know something about Datsun. It seems there's been a lot of economic pressure on them to cut back on quality and features. Pressure like currency revaluations and aggressive advertising by GM, Ford, and Chrysler, especially of their smaller cars. But Datsun won't cut back because they've become a factor in this marketplace by selling a car that offers performance and choice. Choice of styles, sizes, and functions, and performance in every sense of the word. Consumers have recognized this value consistently. And if you doubt it, compare the resale value of Datsun with comparable GM, Ford, or Chrysler cars. Another reason Datsun won't cut back: you can't fool the public. If Datsun marketed a car that performed poorly or had cheaply made parts or bodies that fall apart or give lousy service, sales would go down. But Datsun sales have gone up consistently. Datsun will never cut back. For value, economy, service, and regular gas in most models, doesn't Datsun make sense? Your Metropolitan Datsun dealers are dealing now.
At a time like this, you probably don't care that we use only personally selected hops, or choice barley malt, or pure artesian brewing water. But you'd taste the difference if we didn't. So we do. Olympia. It's a water and a lot
more. Rock Hudson stars in Ice Station Zebra, Saturday at 10:30.
Thank you for coming. Thank you for joining us this Friday night. We have tonight two men who, despite the fact that they had five gold record albums, sold over 10 million LPs, really did not make it big from a mass audience standpoint until a record released last year, which has grossed $60 million so for them.
We
so far, for them.
Too.
Made it in the movie.
No, you said it was a record.
It was a movie.
It was a movie.
Cut! Two budding talk show hosts, Cheech Marin and Tommy Chong.
Hey.
And I'm the one on the show that's straight tonight.
Really?
We're straight.
People magazine called you tasteless, cheerfully tasteless, scatological, and offensive.
What do they know?
Yeah. They're a bunch of fags anyway.
We're a bunch of bleeps. We can't say bleeps. We can't say bleeps.
Usually, they say that the funky smell in the movie theaters when your movie is on is not buttered popcorn.
No.
It's where we made the movie in Smell-O-Rama. So all of a sudden, you see it on the screen, and all of a sudden, you smell it in the movie theater.
Yeah, right. Believe me, you don't need any Smell-O-Rama there.
1984.
We have told this audience that there is to be none of that here tonight. We told you that before the show. Everybody here straight. Well, at least there'll be a couple of them. You know, I think the fact that this movie is doing so well, the fact that you've sold so many records, is really testimony to exactly what is going on in this country with
marijuana. For us, anyway.
You don't mind.
No, we
That's
don't
what
mind.
We figured. You know, they always said, well, what do you think it'll be successful, this movie? And we said, well, it's the first full-on rock and roll dope movie where the headbands win, you know? So I think, yeah, okay.
Usually the bad guys cannot win. Yeah. And in traditional terms, the dopers, the drug smugglers, you and your, what, $9 billion worth of marijuana that you smuggled up from Mexico in a van that was made totally of grass, you won. Yeah. You got away with this stuff.
Well, we didn't get away with it because we never knew it existed. So so we...
Because we're so innocent.
Yes. We don't know what we wouldn't know what to do with $9 billion worth.
Well, to get back to the original point, did you realize this movie, did you think the movie would make it? A movie which really, okay, it's grossed so much money, and so many people have gone to see it, but like many other specialty movies, a lot of people are going to see it again and again and
yeah,
again.
That's what
much like Star Wars, much like Rocky Mountain Hard Show is the same way.
I think because of the Chinese thing, you know, you see it once, half hour later, you got to go back and see it.
So we were thinking of not accepting the money for the people who saw it the second and third time.
Well, I've got a worthy cause.
That's what made it the gross go up.
Yeah.
Was people kept going because they had no choice. There was nothing else out there that they could. That was like what we did. They could go see it.
You never expected it to be this big,
no.
Did you?
Uh-uh. No, I thought it might make it. I thought it might make $400 or $500. You know.
And according to our contract, that's all we make is $400 or $500.
Well, of course, you're feuding with the company as it is, yeah. As far as the profits are concerned.
No, not really. We're winning.
You made a lot of money in records before that.
Yeah.
I mean, 5 gold records. It has to net you some pretty good bread.
Yeah. Well, we we're rich.
and it appears surprisingly straight. I mean, you played a couple of guys who all you cared about was your next joint and where that was coming around,
well,
right around in your hot rod. But I was looking at pictures of your families,
uh-huh,
and your kids.
Mm-hmm.
They look real straight.
Imports. No, money will get you a lot of things.
White women, everything, you know.
No, we wanted to, when we started our career, we wanted to get something that was really close to our lifestyle anyway, you know, so you wouldn't have to be turned on, you know, go on and
wouldn't have to put on your mask to go perform, you know.
Yeah. So we just did ourselves.
Are Pedro and Man you?
Cousins. Distant cousins.
They're elements of us, and they're mostly, you know.
A lot of them.
Yeah, most of it. Most of it.
we've got a clip from the movie, so why don't we take a look? Why don't we take a look at that and see exactly what Pedro and Man are like. They're driving in a car down, it looked like Malibu to me, and smoking something.
Something, yeah.
You ain't scared of a little speed, are you, man?
Oh, you got some speed, man?
Huh? Oh, speed? No, I don't got no speed, man.
I got a joint here, man. I've been saving for a special occasion.
A little fired up.
Yeah, hey, I hope the drums don't mess up your upholstery, man.
Nah, I'm in a band too, man. I'm just a love machine. And I don't work for nobody but you. Open my temperature rise, and then I go for her thighs. And then I say, guacamole in my juice. Guacamole in my juice. Hijo de la chinga. Is that a joint, man?
Now, you guys were watching that every bit as intently as the audience. You really enjoy watching it? How many times have you seen it?
8 million.
A lot. It's still funny.
Yeah.
Still funny.
Yeah.
I want to go back and talk about how you guys met, got together up, where was it, Vancouver?
Yep.
Up in Canada, and how your act came into being, and what you did before you were discovered. We'll do that.
Okay.
Cheech and Chong will be back after we take a short break. Stay with us for more Friday Night.
Add up what you've spent on leathers and vinyls. At today's prices, they'd cost hundreds more. It pays to protect them, so clean them, condition them with the Tannery. Easy to use, spray it on, then wipe it off. Chairs, couches, the dinette set. The Tannery keeps any color shoes, boots, purses, luggage soft and supple, even cleans car interiors. Regular use helps protect leathers and vinyls, helps them last longer. The Tannery has earned the Good Housekeeping seal. Buy the Tannery where furniture polishes are sold.
The Furies, the Lizzies, the Boppers, the Turnbull ACs, the Riffs.
Riff! Yeah!
These are Furies of the night. 100,000 strong, they could run New York City. Tonight, they're out to get the Warriors. The Warriors, rated R.
See Warriors, now showing at a theater near you.
Chicago Health Clubs is having a white sale. Due to all the snow, rates will not increase until February 11th. Join now.
Cheech Marin and Tommy Chong are the beginning of a new breed, I would say, of comedians. They used to joke about, all the comedians joked about drunks, about drinking. Then they joked about beats. You guys are really the beginning of the new wave starting to get into drug-oriented material. How did that start?
Well, with drugs.
we formed a band. We were in an improv group. It was a topless nightclub.
It was called the Make the Excuse for the Rent Improv Group.
And the improv group broke up, as all improv groups break up. And so Cheech and I formed a band. And our first gig was in front of about 5,000 screaming rock and roll fanatics. And we got out there, and we hadn't played that much music, but we had done all this comedy. So we started doing comedy. And the people loved it. And we said, hey, if we can entertain these animals, you know, we are on our way to...
You really started when a music group bombed?
Well, it was our music group.
You're not admitting that it bombed.
No, we never
got around to playing.
We started comedy, and we got trapped into it. We could never get around to getting, you know, playing. It just went one laugh into another. And next thing you know, we did 45 minutes, and we were off. We took our bow. We did an encore, went back, and we said, you and me, baby. Yeah.
Was it drugs from the beginning?
Sex and drugs.
Your typical American
classical subjects.
Do you ever think you'd make so much money, get so much fame from, you know, what is still a patently illegal?
I was just
illegal
worried about
thing.
Getting back across the border.
You're from L.A., right?
Yeah, I'm from L.A., but I went up to Canada to avoid the draft, and then I was still wanted in the United States by the FBI when I came back, so I had to come back with a phony ID and a different accent, you know?
And you went underground and kept yourself very invisible.
Yeah, we'd play little clubs, and Tommy would always go, here's a bad dog. You know?
We may have some viewers tonight from the Immigration Service.
That's okay. I got my green card.
That's okay. I paid them off already anyway.
So after you went and at the improv group in Vancouver, what happened after that?
Then we went to Los Angeles and started playing all the clubs we could find that could where we could work. We played a lot of black clubs because they had a format where they had a floor show. And so we used to go and do a lot of black clubs. And we did all the freebies, you know, the troubadour. We used to line up at 10 o'clock in the morning to get on at 8 o'clock at night, you know. And we'd stand in line and eat sunflower seeds and spit them on the sidewalk, you know.
You know, just exactly like the scene in Up in Smoke.
Yeah.
In the back door of the Battle of the Bands.
We did that about five or six times at the troubadour.
And it got to the point where we started getting our fans phoning up and saying, are Cheech and Chong going to be on tonight? And then Lou Adler, you know, was there, and he found us, and we started recording for him, and then the rest was uphill all the way.
Uphill all the way. So a lot of the movie is really biographical.
Oh, yeah.
All your material is. Yeah, I remember you said, reading an interview with you somewhere where you said that.
You can't think up that stuff. You have to live through it and then think back on it, you know, and then put it into a form where people can enjoy it with you.
They say the audience is always stoned.
Our audiences? No, we did a film festival in Dallas, Texas. Was it
American? Yeah, American Film Festival.
And
SMU.
They had, I mean, the uniform of the day was plaid pants and blue hair, you know. And there wasn't a stick of dope anywhere in the theater, and we were worried, you know, because if anything, I just wanted to get high anyway. But they showed the film to these people. They loved it. They sat there and loved it. And
a lot of people came
and
in.
Now you play all over the place. You're at Mill Run this weekend, doing a show tonight, earlier tonight. Hype. Two shows tomorrow night and one show on Sunday. Did I get it right?
Yeah, that's right.
The agreement?
Yeah. Well, why don't we go over it one more time? There's one show tonight, two shows Saturday, and one show Sunday.
And that's apt to be a more straight crowd than goes down to the
to the Village Probably. Theater up, yeah. up here on the north side.
Well, hopefully we're
smoke
their
joints and watch up and smoke.
Yeah, well, hopefully we're going to have a lot of people that were suffering from cabin fever, you know, that need a laugh.
Want to get out, yeah.
And we, in our show itself, we don't just do drug humor. We do other things, you know. We, like, what else?
Would you like to do a more traditional setup? For instance, would you like to be a member of the Not Ready for Primetime Players on Saturday Night Live or something like that?
No.
Would that be out of your bag?
Too much work.
It's too much out of our control. See, everything we've done, we've had control. The writing, the producing, the directing, and everything. And that's fun. That's when it's fun. Because you don't have to answer to someone or you don't have to.
Yeah, but the bigger you get, the more control you lose. It's in any business.
No.
From manufacturing to television
to
anywhere.
Well, to an extent. I mean, the way you do it.
Did you think I made up these questions?
No, what we're going to do, if we get that big, we'll sell it. And start over again.
We'll have Cheech and Chong clones.
You could.
We got them right here.
Put them guys on the road.
Any volunteers?
Yeah, sure. Anybody want to go out and make a living smoking dope and talk about it?
Please put that out in the back. You could go to Malibu and never work again.
Yeah, but
that's what I had planned on, but all of a sudden I looked at my bank account and,
That's no fun either. It's fun getting out on the road.
Yeah.
It really is. We meet a lot of nice people, a lot of crazy people.
What do you think of nightclubs as opposed to recording and movies?
Well, the nightclubs generally have more people in them than the...
They're more
recording.
Fun. They're more fun.
Where's Chili Pepper when I
meet? Nightclubs are fun. Yeah, that's the
fun.
Really, it's a more esoteric medium.
You get to look at the waitresses too.
What's the new movie about?
The new movie?
It's going to be more characters, but basically the same. Different problems, but the same problems.
You ever think you'll run out of marijuana material?
Gee, I hope not.
not as long as there's Columbia. When that falls off the shelf, we're in trouble.
But then don't forget, we got Peru, too, you know. We got the cocaine jokes, too, to worry about.
Actually, we're getting into the more serious drama, probably our next movie. A lot of criticism because our movie wasn't so serious this time, so we're going to make a musical comedy version of The Clubbing of the Baby Seals. Real big.
Should be a smash.
Yeah.
Or smashed, anyway. Coming up next, Craig Kopitas, who is the editor-in-chief of High Times Magazine, will be joining us. We'll talk a little bit about Santa Marta Gold and the other good stuff.
Good.
After we take a short break. Stay with us for Cheech and Chong and more on Friday night.
From Dominic's Produce Department comes U.S. number one russet potatoes. A 10-pound bag is only 77 cents. Shop and save at Dominic's, Chicagoland's most complete food stores.
Extra, extra, read it here. Long gets 100 Camaros. Long gets 150 Camaros. Long gets 200 Camaros. Long Chevrolet has all the colors. Long has every model in stock. Long Chevrolet has a volume sales program. Make a deal at a volume dealer. Buy a brand new Camaro today. Extra, extra, all new cars. Track checked at Long Chevrolet. Extra, extra, read all about it. Long Chevrolet Elmhurst. Extra, extra, read all about it. Long Chevrolet Elmhurst.
What's inside the yogurt you buy? Dannon says, read the outside, front and back. Some brands have natural flavor. They may also have artificial color. Some are all natural. They may also have starch and other additives. And some yogurts have no active yogurt cultures. Dannon says, natural yogurt with active cultures. And that's exactly what you get.
Now, I'm no prude, but you know that time has kind of passed you by when you pick up your local picture magazine and open up the centerfold and are really not turned on by its content. This picture, of course, is of mounds and mounds of cocaine. The magazine is High Times, and its senior editor is Craig Kopitas, who is joining us now. I especially like the segment in High Times, which talks about recent events, busts in the drug world, and the section is called High Witness News.
Right, right. We've got to be high when you write it.
You really do well for a market. Well. Yeah. You know, High Times magazine is destined only for people who use drugs.
Well, that's a great deal of our readership do indeed use drugs, but you'd be surprised the number of people who don't use drugs who read it. It's quite staggering. It's,
come on.
Oh, really? It's true.
How many people read this?
About 4 million, according to the season one poll.
You make money?
Oh, yeah. Awesome. All legal, though.
Does very well.
Yeah.
How did the idea? You know, I have a story to tell you about High Times magazine that you may not know. I was talking with the Attorney General of Colombia.
My attorneys are over there, and if you're saying
a while ago. Talking with the Attorney General of Colombia, and he picks up the High Times magazine, which has the banana boat.
Oh yeah.
Usually the banana boat and the cocaine in the bananas.
Right.
And he says part of this thing is what's wrong with a free press system. In the United States. Magazines like this, dirt that should never be on the streets.
Well, he was just upset because, you see, that scam of smuggling cocaine and bananas used to be his scam, and then we found out about it and thought we should let the rest of the world know.
Well, you know, you say such...
He had to switch to guavas.
Yeah.
You say such nice things about the Colombians. Like, I notice here, you say that one of the drug peddlers, Lucho Barranquilla, who died in a Santa Marta street from accidental collision with several rounds of small arms fire.
Yeah. This occasionally happens, you know.
It's the New York Times of drug literature.
You know, just happened to be out there.
Got caught in a storm.
What can you do? It's a wild business. It's worth a lot of money, the drug business. Everyone takes recreational drugs. You know, there's
No, wait.
Well,
you're talking
about one out of five adults in this country have
that's
at least
based on the figure of 40 million, right?
Well,
40,
that government
45 million?
That government figure I think is a bit low. If you agree with the statistic that we've come up with, in which even the people over drug enforcement have agreed with, that there's anywhere between 27 and 30 tons minimal of marijuana smoked every day in the United States, then you're talking about a lot more people than what the government says is around 15 to 18 million people smoking marijuana. It's a lot of people out there. I mean, it's a big business.
Even by the government's estimate, you have the government saying, I think it was in a recent Time magazine, they were quoted as saying that we pay more money to Colombia for marijuana and cocaine than to Japan for TV sets and automobiles.
Sure. Also,
that's staggering.
Yeah, it is. Well, you know, the market's there. You know, people like to get high. They have for years. And
then they're staggering.
That's right. it's the old concept of, you know, diminishing returns, you know.
And everybody's getting rich. Cheech and Chong
are
getting rich.
I'm not getting rich. These guys are getting rich. I ain't getting rich.
You're just a
I get
editor.
Shot at, you know, I mean.
When did you get shot at?
Well, I have to go down to these. You go to Columbia, you know, hey, I'm from ABC News, you know. Nice guy. They look...
That's
nice
right.
to see it. When I get down hat. There, I got to get down. I got to wear a flak jacket. I crawl out in the fields to see the, you know, take pictures of the pot fields. I go into cocaine laboratories. You know, it gets pretty grim at times, you know.
People
like
to
smell the stuff that's
you
got to
check it out, make sure that the consumer is getting quality merchandise. this is an important consideration.
You never know what's in that stuff.
Yeah, paraquat,
right.
Who knows? Dr. Scholl's foot powders.
You told me about your recent trip to where was it, to Bogota, where they took you into the locker, the drug locker?
Oh, right, yeah. Well, it's the head of DOS, which is the Colombian equivalent of our DEA, the head of it took me into their evidence locker and had these chairs that they had confiscated that were full of cocaine, and he has this big grin on his face, and he opens one of them up, and he says, "You like to try some?" And 3 months later, he was put in jail because the government found out that he had a bank account he wasn't telling anyone about, something like 5 or 6 million pesos. Not that much, but, you know, we knew what he was doing.
Relatively small. What about the morality of all this? I mean, obviously, what you're talking about is illegal. What you're writing about is illegal. Does that bother you?
No, not
it's
as
just a technicality.
Me.
Technicality, did you get 5 to 10 for?
Booze was illegal during the Depression, or, you know, during the Prohibition, I mean.
It bothers me to the extent that the government could solve a lot of problems if they just legalized it.
Right. That's the
What bothers me. I mean, it would, you know, then we could be on the Johnny Carson show, you know.
That's right. Instead of Chicago freezing outside.
What's wrong with this program? You guys want to leave now? I mean, I won't tell anybody about Mill Run and then see where you are. An empty house.
All we get is coffee.
And they give us real water on that show.
Then you could be hosting a Johnny Carson show.
No, thank you.
You've heard of Stanley
like
Siegel?
In New York.
Yeah, right.
Talk show host in New York.
You know, I can take care of it for you.
He talks about it.
Talk about it later. No, and you know what upsets me? Seriously, what upsets me is that the government of this country constantly says, well, we can't legalize it because all the kids are taking it. And that's a cop-out on the government's part. Because
there was an editorial, and was it in High Times recently? I think it was in Paraphernalia Digest, which editorialized against selling drug paraphernalia to kids.
Yeah, it was there. We've done similar ones. And I think it's a good idea because there is an abuse potential for anything. And the fact of the matter is that right now there aren't that many people informing the youth of this country the problems with drugs. You know, we were talking before outside, and you know, Tommy had said there are some people who just can't smoke marijuana. And he's right, just like there are some people who can't drink, some people who can't eat meat. And it's something that the government just kind of closes the door on as opposed to opening it up and saying, look, let's legalize this stuff, let's listen to what the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws is saying and regulate it. And get the tax money on it, and the tax money that we get from it, let's put it back into drug education.
Yeah, I want to get to the medical question of whether or not smoking marijuana is safe. There's a controversy going on. Many people say it's not harmful at all. Others say there's a problem with heartbeat, problem with chromosomes, problem with male hormones, and all that.
Also, we'll get to appendages.
I just had this operation.
You know.
I got a problem with being oversexed.
Well, if you smoke marijuana, you should be undersexed.
Or it works opposite with me. Girls.
stay with us. Andy Cowell, who's the publisher of Paraphernalia Digest, will be along in just a minute, and we'll have more on Friday night.
Somewhere in these Chiricahua hills, no white man will ever know where, the Apaches buried Cochise, the greatest of their great chiefs. Geronimo faded into these hills, and it took 5,000 U.S. soldiers to bring him out. And now Time Life Books brings the great chiefs to life again as your introductory volume to a fast-writing series called The Old West. Hundreds of authentic pictures give you the real story. For the first time ever, you'll be able to see Geronimo's combat dagger and Colt 45. You'll look into the eyes of Sitting Bull, the man who destroyed Custer. Quanah Parker, the fierce Comanche whose mother was a captured farm girl, and all the great chiefs. Eyewitness accounts and rare photographs and art bring the Old West to life. You'll meet the gunfighters. Men like John Wesley Hardin, so mean he once shot a man just for snoring. The cowboys, blazed in glory by the greatest artists of the Old West. The pioneers, battling the savage elements and bloodthirsty war parties. The gamblers, the women of the West. They're all here in big, handsome books with the look and feel of hand-tooled saddle leather. We'll send you the great chiefs for a free 10-day examination. If you're not impressed, just return it within 10 days and pay nothing. If you decide to keep the great chiefs, you pay just $9.95 plus shipping and handling. Then approximately every other month, we'll send you another lively volume from the Old West Library, free for a 10-day examination. Keep only the volumes you want. You can cancel at any time. Here's how to order.
Phone toll-free 800-327-0444 or write Great Chief, 276 Time Life Building, Chicago. We'll send qualified buyers the volume free for 10 days with no obligation to buy. Phone toll-free 800-327-0444.
Not only are illegal drugs a multi-billion-dollar-a-year business for many people, but the paraphernalia
The items that you use, what are they called? Roaches and snorters and razor blades and things
Shovels.
Like that. All the things. All the things that
brains. Are
Trucks, a $9 billion car. All the things that are used in drug use are a multi-million-dollar business. I think about $350 million. And Andy Cowell is the publisher of Paraphernalia Digest, which runs down all these new products and toys and inventions.
Well, we're the trade magazine, and we go just to the trades, the people who sell it and distribute it and manufacture it.
It's gotten so big that you form what's called a PTA, right?
No, please. That's the other guys. We're the Paraphernalia Trade Association. Actually, we dropped the T in the middle because we're always the PTA, the Parents and Teachers Association, is the ones who are always getting on our case, you know. Mm. Right outside of Chicago here, there's about 9 communities that are trying to outlaw paraphernalia, so...
So you guys have PPC now?
We're PC.
Angel dust.
We lose track. We've been through a lot of them.
What do people make to use?
What do they
make? What are the biggest
sellers?
Well,
our industry...
We've got rolling papers, obviously.
Well, they got straws out, you know?
Well, the interesting thing is that what they make is are sold all over town also. I mean, for example, they make straws. You could use a straw from McDonald's. You can...
That's the snort cocaine, the sniff cocaine.
Allegedly. And you know, rolling papers and roach clips, which are alligator clips often, the same kind you buy in an electrical supply store.
To hold a marijuana cigarette. You have to explain it. I mean, I'm not...
Okay, well, see, what happens...
I'm not
happens
the great drug user.
This comes
here.
Out to see you. I understand. Groundhog Day, you know?
See, what happens is they sell a lot of these things, and sometimes the reason I'm used to not explaining it is because often I'm opposed to some senator who's trying to outlaw this stuff, and he's saying, well, they use it only to... smoke dope, and we say, well, no, they could use it for other things as well.
I use electrical all the time to put electrical wires together. You know. All right. Keep it in your pocket.
It's good for holding sutures.
You know, stick it on. My favorite's always been the toilet paper roll, you know, with a little aluminum foil.
Well, that's the thing. Sometimes
you're selling,
what's that?
Oh, you see...
Empty toilet paper.
Don't
roll.
Laugh at me.
They're going to outlaw toilet paper.
You're my friends.
I mean, this is something that affects you all.
It's an empty toilet paper roll, and you cover one end, and you cut a hole in the top, right? And
right.
You put a tin foil on top, and you put a leafy substance
yeah.
on top, and you light it.
It's kind of an emergency bong. Yeah.
And if these paraphernalia laws and legislators who are trying to outlaw paraphernalia get their way, I mean, everyone in this audience will go without toilet paper. They have to go back like, you know, the Ayatollah Khomeini, you know.
We can't
down
stop
brush
technology.
It's grim news, you know. I'm
future
sorry
shock
to come here to
people.
Tell you this.
You people, the people from the Paraphernalia Trade Association and all the paraphernalia manufacturers, yeah. took over the whole, Exposition Center in New York for a very big show.
Well,
recently.
It's been going on for a number of years. It's
yeah,
called
three times a year, something
boutique like? Show. It's three times a year, and actually they have other things there like posters and jeans. But that's where we meet. It's where we congregate and sell paraphernalia to the retailers. And sell the rolling papers to the guys who are selling it on the street.
It's a big business. I've been in headshots of old ladies where they don't even know what you're buying it for. And well, here's a nice pipe over here that's really, really popular with the young kids today.
I once a number of years ago, before I found out, realized what people were doing. The guy was wearing a razor blade around his neck, and I said, "What in the world is he wearing a razor blade around his
Just
neck?
In case
is
he
shaved?"
I was having a
razor blade, of course, is to make little lines of cocaine to sniff.
Well, the ultimate piece of paraphernalia is having dinner a week or so ago with Al Goldstein, who's a publisher of Screw, and he had around his neck a gold-plated razor, not the razor blade, but the whole apparatus.
Well, that's for different reasons.
It's like anti-paraphernalia.
Moving right along.
He's a touch-up artist.
So you know you've made it is when you get a hash pipe named after you. You know, like someday there may be the Jay Levine pipe.
I would hope they'd call it Levine, but that's another point. Welcome to Chicago. It's obviously impossible to get a line on illegal drugs, a dollar figure on illegal drugs. It's not impossible to get a dollar figure on paraphernalia,
which
can be used basically only for drugs. Now, all this nonsense about, it can be used for something else, sure.
Well, for example, they sell in last year... Well, I forget how many hundred million, but there were a few hundred million packages of rolling paper sold in this country. So if that's any indication, they're not buying rolling paper when they run out of writing paper. So right. It's got to be an indication of some sort of use.
What's the dollar figure on drug paraphernalia bought in this country? Give me an accurate figure.
The one that has been kicking around is about $300 million. But it's elusive because we don't have, it's not like the automobile industry and other industry where it's public companies and yeah, right, exactly. No, we don't know what we sell exactly.
Well, is it illicit? It's not illicit, though, is it?
Paraphernalia? No, absolutely not.
It's totally legal.
But any business, you always have two sets of books.
They supported us.
The movie business, too?
Especially the movie business.
Shoeboxes.
Our movie grows $60 million. Wait till we ask them when, oh, well,
check comes in.
You did $20 million.
Lucky. That's all, huh?
Sure.
Well, that of course is a big controversy that goes back a long time, sure, about how they figure, the accountants
money
figure the money.
Money has a weird way of sticking to people's fingers, you know, when it goes through certain areas. Some of it sticks, you know.
You know, they've supported us for, what, 5 years now, the paraphernalia industry. We work with very little blue chip advertising. In fact, we had looked for years to find some automotive manufacturer to advertise in High Times, and we all had like little bets who was going to be the first to advertise in High Times. I thought it might be, you know, Volkswagen or a nice, inexpensive car. It turned out to be Rolls-Royce.
Really? Rolls-Royce advertised in High Times?
Yeah, they had for one of their limousine services and sales things in New York. They took out an ad.
Well, what that was, I used to work with Craig. I used to be the publisher of High Times, and we traded once in a while. We traded advertising with the Rolls-Royce limo service, so they gave us an open tab, and we gave them a few ads.
I see. Well, you know, in a number of years, a lot of the big companies are going to be involved in this as the big tobacco companies get into marijuana. Maybe we can get into that a little bit later. Also, we'll have the audience asking some questions to Cheech and Chong, or our two publishers, all that and more.
Now,
so
I'm a
stay
publisher.
Up with us. Senior editor, publisher, small step.
Giving you more for your money is what made Toyota dealers number one again last year in import car sales in America. We got off to a fast start this year, too. And to stay number one in 79, we've got to keep up the pace in February. We've got a huge selection of 1979 Toyota cars and trucks ready for immediate delivery and our fast start deals to go with them. So get yourself a number one deal today on America's number one import, Toyota.
See your local Toyota dealer.
Menswear sales, a dime a dozen, but they're...